So in this week's video, I want to delve into what actually makes for a fantastic photo. Not just a great photo, but a fantastic photo. And that is, of course, highly, highly subjective. Let's just take Ansel Adams, as per always, as an example. Some people really, really adore his photos. He's famous. He's probably the most famous landscape photographer of all time. While other people think that his photos are not really that interesting. So obviously highly subjective. But I do think there are some things that most of us can agree about that we could probably put into a checklist so we can agree that that ought to make for a fantastic photo. So the keen-eyed of you out there may actually see that I am not in Denmark right now. So Sophie and I are out on a small vacation along the northern coast of Germany on the Baltic seaside, and we have come to this forest that I wanted to photograph for a long time called Gespensterwald. So you can see right out there I have the ocean, and if I just continue that way, I reach back home in Denmark. And coming to such a special forest, but also a very touristy forest, and actually a forest that is fairly famous among photographers, there's like a filming crew right here, right now, I might actually already have excluded myself from making a fantastic photo, because originality is usually something that most photographers highly value. So besides originality, one thing that all fantastic photos do have in common is that the settings of your camera are optimized. Like, you want to have the technicals in order. So you want to have, like, you know, optimal shutter speed for whatever it is you want to do, optimal aperture for whatever you want to do. You need to have whatever it is you're photographing in focus, white balance, all that stuff in order. So right now I am photographing with the long lens up towards these gnarly trees right here. You can see this here is the composition I have found. And as you can see, I'm actually shooting at f/18, but on the 100 to 400 millimeter, that is not too bad at all in regard to diffraction. That gives me a shutter speed of 1/15th of a second, ISO 100, but I shoot at such a low aperture simply just because I want to have as much in focus as possible, at least the main branches of my composition. So you need to have the technicals in order. I also shot this shot this morning. We were here this morning. I had hoped for a little bit of moist in the air, some fog, something, so we could get some interesting light down through the trees, but it never really manifested. So I got a lot of soft light from an overcast sky instead. And right now I'm here with more direct light. I do not know which one of the photos I will prefer. I will find out when I come back home. But the two photos do have that in common, that I've optimized the technicals. Next thing that's also super important is that you don't confuse the viewer. Like, you need to have some kind of subject, a concept, or at the very least a focal point. And yeah, right now I am photographing in this direction here. So I have Sophie right in the middle, and she is my focal point. And the concept is, of course, all these beautiful tall beech trees, naked beech trees. So I've got a few different versions basically of this photo here. And yeah, as you know, there's nothing worse than a sharp photo of a fuzzy subject or a fuzzy concept. So make sure that you're not confusing the viewer. And to not confuse the viewer, it is of course important that you use composition to your advantage. Now, I personally really like the central composition. Like, most of my photos has a tendency to have the focal point or the subject right smack in the middle of the frame, or at least like well within the middle, maybe not straight in the middle, but within the middle. And that is also to get a balanced photo. And you want to also make sure that you have your horizon line or the perception of the horizon in your photo to be straight, and use leading lines. In this case here, as you can see, I'm using this trail to lead into the photo. And of course, I use the light, the side light, to light up all the trees down through the photo. In this particular case, sadly, I don't have any fog. Fog is usually really, really great to create that sense of depth in a forest scene. So generally, think about your composition, think about the structure of your photo. That was what I talked about in last week's video. And if you want to learn more about composition in landscape photography, I talk so much about how I use different compositional tools, not rules, tools, to tell the story or the concept, show the concept in your photos. And then you can of course choose whichever tools will benefit you in that case. So be sure to check out my eBooks if you want to learn much more about composition in landscape photography. There are links down in the description. This composition right here is of course also super hard to photograph because there are so many people on these trails. So it's full of people who are biking and walking and generally just people who want to come and enjoy the sunset. And that is of course always the negative part of photographing sunsets in locations where there's a lot of people. There's just a lot of people, a lot of distractions, and a lot of people that goes within your shot. That is what it is. That is also one of the reasons why I prefer to shoot during morning. But the light is of course better during the evening right here. And that is the next thing I want to talk about. The special thing in your photo. Now, right now, I'm of course in this fairly unique forest. You don't get these kind of beech trees in a whole lot of places on planet Earth. So it's fairly unique. You can get these very straight line trees. And obviously there's a lot of other unique places around Earth, so-called icons, and some of them do become photography icons. Let's just mention Mesa Arch as one of them. And it is special. You take a photo of something that's special, something that gets fantastic. Obviously, over time, you can argue whether or not there's a whole lot of originality left when you go photographing icons. But at the very least, what I mean is that you're taking a photo of something fantastic. Your subject, the scene itself, is unique. Now, obviously, you do not need a scene to be super unique to make a fantastic photo. You really don't. But in that case, I would argue that you will need special conditions. So the special light, all the special things that non-photographers usually do not get, like special atmosphere, special light, special conditions, northern lights, all those things that non-photographers usually do not photograph. And the good thing is, of course, if you can combine like special locations, unique locations, interesting locations with interesting conditions, then usually you are well on your way to create a fantastic photo. So for the lack of a better word or a better phrase, it's about finding that X factor that makes your photo stand out beyond all the other photos that are out there. Thank you. So we have made it to the final destination of this little tour. Well, at least for photography, it is vacation for us. But it is just these absolutely fantastic trees right here, as you can see. How about that? So yeah, I'm just going around trying to find different cool compositions, and the first one here I'm working with, you can see right here, something like this. So I'm using the leaves right here to frame the upper part right here. As you can see, my settings are right now f8, so I get a little bit of blur in the tree there, and ISO 200, simply just so I can get a little bit of a faster shutter speed. As long as it's windy like this, I'm trying to my best degree to get non-blurred branches and leaves. It's a little bit hard, but yeah, really cool place. So sadly, I just find this photo to be too messy, and I relatively fast concluded that when I saw it on a bigger screen. But I wanted you to see it now that I had already recorded this sequence and described the photo in the field. The photo also really shows how much of a difference fog and lack of holes in the canopy makes when you do woodland photography. Not that there is a big chance of fog in such a condensed location anyway. So one thing that might be a little bit annoying and a little bit unpopular in regard to making world-class fantastic photos is that it seems to also come down to the persona who actually takes the photos. The person. Who is that person? If it's Ansel Adams, think about it, like, he did a lot of nature protection work. He made a lot of the work that goes into all the national parks and all those things, and he's very much credited for that work. So beyond photography, he also did a lot of good stuff for humanity, environmentalism. So from what I can see is that it is not only down to the photographs, it has also something to do with the photographer beyond photography. So you do get into this positive circle that you do a lot of good stuff outside of photography, and that shines upon your photography. Just think about it the other way around. Like, think about an artist who has become fairly famous for some good creative work, and then that one artist does something that is illegal. Then we have a person who really falls from fame and becomes infamous or whatever. So it seems to me that it is not only down to the creative work, but also what the creative person does beyond his or her field of creation. In this photo, I really love the composition. It's actually a vertical panorama taken with my 20mm f1.8, as I had forgotten my 16-35mm. Well, I hadn't forgotten it, I just mistakenly grabbed my 24-105 instead and had brought two standard zoom lenses. Duh. But for the photo, I really love how you can see the shape of this rather threatening figure, maybe a witch, along with its comrades in the background. I do think this photo with autumn leaves or entirely without leaves would have been better. The green color doesn't really complement the subject. I did try a black and white conversion, which is something I've delved a bit into lately. More of that in the future. But I'm not entirely sure about it either. It surely makes the shapes of the trunks and the branches stand out more and give it a bit more dark and gritty feeling, which I do think complements the subject. It is also something very different to what I usually make. Let me hear your opinion in the comments below. Does it work with the black and white conversion, or do you prefer it in color? So another point of actually making really fantastic photos is that you will most likely have to do some kind of editing. Now remember, a raw photo is not designed to look like reality. It's not designed to be a representation of reality. So no matter if you want to make a photo that is exactly as you saw it here and now when you take the photo, or you want to be more artistic about your editing, you will have to edit. There's no way around it. Just remember that there's different kind of image profiles when you shoot in JPEG. Which one is the one that represents truth the most? Is it the one called faithful, like faithful to the scene? Is it the standard one? You know it's standard, so it's probably how it looks like. Is it the one called landscape? Usually not. Black and white, definitely not. So there's also one called neutral. So neutral, that must imply that there's no editing to it. Thereby it must be the one that is the most true. So whether you're shooting JPEG or RAW, if you want to have something that looks like reality, then you will have to edit. So again, if you want to make really fantastic photos, you need to learn some proper editing. And obviously I have my Photoshop for Landscape Photographers tutorial. So if you want to learn more about editing, where I share all my different tricks and tools I use that you can apply in the way you want to apply it, then definitely check out that course. There is a link down in the description with a coupon code, and I made it very easy and very systematic, so you can get through it onto the level where you want to go and pull out the tools that you want to use for your editing. Link down in the description. This photo is probably my favorite of the day, although not the best conditions, again, but like the last photo, I really like the composition. The strong, gnarly foreground is both framing and complementing the background. This is actually an example where it makes great sense to include a strong foreground. It's just an absolutely gorgeous and unique location, but I don't really think that I got any world-class photos away from here. But my last thoughts on what makes for a world-class photo is we can have a lot of skillful photographers judge each other's photos. And by doing so, because we are professionals, it's like professional chefs judging different dishes, then we have learned a lot of different attributes that we put value into as landscape photographers. And even if we have a collective of these skillful photographers judging a photo and saying it's a great photo, it's a world-class photo, if that photo is not being acknowledged by a broad audience and people don't like it, even though it was put into an exhibition in, I don't know, Louvre in Paris, then can we actually say it's a world-class landscape photo? If there's not a broad agreement beyond the landscape photography community that it's a great photo, will it then ever be a world-class photo? So these were a few of my thoughts in regard to what actually makes for a world-class landscape photo. If I missed something or if you have any inputs, be sure to write it down in the comments, because this is such a subjective thing. I'm actually super curious to read your guys' thoughts on what makes for a world-class photo. And again, remember, it's very, very subjective, but is there some objective values that we can put onto it, or attributes that we could put on to a world-class photo? Be sure to check out all the links in the description. I hope you enjoyed these two locations from me and Sophie's 1 week trip to northern Germany. It was long overdue to actually get out the door and photograph something else than Denmark. But next week's video, I will be back in Denmark. And yeah, so yeah, links in the description. Let me know down in the comments your thoughts about this theme, and thank you so much for watching.